Building support for a military campaign against the Islamic State group, the U.S. seeks a global coalition to take on fighters who've seized large areas of Syria and Iraq. But can regional powers work together? This is Inside Story. Hello, welcome to the program. In Doha, I'm Adrian Finnegan. US President Barack Obama is building a coalition of nations to combat the threat posed by the Islamic State group, a threat that the White House says now extends beyond Iraq to the wider region and the world. And to defeat the group, the US is reaching out to friends, allies, and foes alike, calling for a common effort, even if it means that some governments will work with others that they would ordinarily oppose. Nine mostly European nations agreed to join the US-led coalition at a NATO meeting in Wales. The UK, France, Canada, Australia, Germany, Turkey, Italy, Poland and Denmark are expected to lend military and financial support. And on Monday, US State Department spokeswoman Jen Psaki told a briefing that more than 40 nations had contributed to the broader effort in Iraq, from supplying arms to humanitarian assistance.
There are obviously a range of capabilities or capacities that different countries have. The focus will be on multiple lines of effort, including military support to our Iraqi partners, stopping the flow of foreign fighters, countering ISIL's financing and funding, addressing humanitarian crises, and delegitimizing ISIL's ideology.
And the U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry is now visiting the Middle East, enlisting the support of Arab nations for what's being called a coalition of the willing and capable, all of which gives us plenty to talk about on today's Inside Story. So let's bring in our guests. Joining me here in the studio, Ibrahim Shakir, Deputy Director at the Brookings Doha Center and Conflict Resolution Professor at Georgetown University. From Dubai today, we're joined by Ali Kaderi, CEO of the strategic consultancy Dragoman Partners and a former special assistant to five US ambassadors in Iraq. And joining us from Washington, D.C., Phyllis Bennis, Director at the Institute for Policy Studies and author of the book Ending the Iraq War, a primer. Welcome to you all. Ibrahim, we'll start with you. As the US Secretary of State, then, John Kerry, gets down to this task of building a coalition of what he describes as the coalition, the willing and the able, what are the main obstacles that he faces?
Well, he obviously faces so many obstacles, but the most serious of them actually is coming to the region that is saturated of wars and bombings, and expected to sell an idea of an additional bombing or a new war. That is the most serious challenge, keeping in mind that who's going actually to market this idea and to sell the idea of no bombing is Secretary Kerry, with a history of systematic failure of U.S. wars in the region, starting with Iraq and then going to Libya and Yemen and Afghanistan and all of that. So this history of failure of U.S. bombings and U.S. wars in the region does not support and keeps does not support Secretary Kerry at all in convincing this region of an additional bombing. In addition, of course, this region now is having a vicious sectarian conflict. Kerry is expected to bring parties that traditionally don't get along very well together, Saudi Arabia, Iran, other countries like Jordan as well, that faces serious internal challenges of joining such a coalition. So Secretary Kerry is expected to work with all these contradictions and build the coalitions, which is not an easy task.
Ali Kaderi in Dubai, if politics makes for strange bedfellows, so do coalitions. What do you envisage this coalition looking like, and what are the dangers of relying on local partners whose real aims may be very different to those of the US government?
Well, for this effort to be successful, the coalition will need to consist of the United States, the Five Eyes coalition, which is Canada, UK, New Zealand, and Australia, our NATO allies, and our regional allies, Turkey, Jordan, the GCC countries, and Egypt. There will also have to be some form of cooperation with Iran and Syria, given their malign role in Iraq historically. Unfortunately, though, this cannot be a military operation alone. The military line of operation has an important component, but it needs to be nested within a grand strategy, a coherent foreign policy and regional strategy for the Middle East. And that's what President Obama has lacked since he has taken office. And really, it's what got us to this point. The fact that he has exercised a policy of what he thought was benign neglect has actually turned out to be a policy of malignant neglect. And the fact that the administration in Washington supported Nouri al-Maliki for the past 4 years, really unconditionally, while they sat back and watched as Maliki exercised a very sectarian government, disenfranchised and disillusioned Iraq's Sunni Arabs a second time, has directly led to this crisis. They've also sat back and watched as a genocide was perpetuated in Syria for the past 3 years. 200,000 Syrians have been killed, millions more have been displaced, leading to about 25 million Sunni Arabs in Iraq and in Syria to again be disenfranchised and disillusioned. And we've seen throughout time, it's just human nature, when individuals are disenfranchised and disillusioned and left hopeless, they become radicalized and they become militant.
Right.
And so the solution has to be a new form of government in Baghdad, a new form of government in Damascus that exercises good governance and integrates those communities so that they all feel like first-class citizens of those countries. Otherwise, this will fail miserably and only lead to a further regional conflict, perhaps a regional holy war.
Phyllis Bennis, what do you make of what you just heard there? 9 years of war in Iraq, the invasion and subsequent occupation said to have fueled the insurgency there. What's to say that further foreign involvement in Iraq now won't lead to further violence and unrest rather than less?
I think it is inevitable that it will lead to further violence and unrest and not less. We've been down this road before. The language, I was shocked, I must say, to hear the Obama administration echoing the exact language of George Bush's coalition of the willing, what we then called the coalition of the coerced. But whatever you call it, it's a coalition of killing. I don't think that's going to help. We need to take the military stuff off the agenda, because what is portrayed here by the press in the United States and what is seen by Americans as, yay, we're going after the bad guys, we're getting the terrorists, is, as your guests have described, it's perceived in the region, most especially in Iraq, as here's the U.S. acting as the air force for the Kurdish Peshmerga and the Shia government in Iraq. It is not seen as going after bad guys. It's seen as a player in a civil war. It's not surprising, for all the reasons we've just heard, that there is significant support for ISIS, something that is not discussed, not recognized, not acknowledged here in the United States, that ISIS, as extreme and brutal and violent as it is supported not because of its violence, but despite its violence, because the violence of the Iraqi government, the sectarianism of the Iraqi government, the kind of dispossession and disenfranchisement that we've been hearing about, this has been so severe that ordinary Sunnis, former military people who happen to be Sunnis, the Sunni tribal leaders, all of whom have been willing to ally themselves with ISIS, in some cases joining, in some cases fighting in parallel, because they see that as the only way to challenge this terrible government that the U.S. has propped up, not for 4 years, but really it's the same government that's been in place since the U.S. invasion.
You raise some issues that I want to come back to in just a moment. First of all, let me tell you about some figures from the U.S. that show that the U.S. president doesn't appear to need to do a great deal to convince Americans of the need for action right now. According to recent polls, 76% of Americans want more airstrikes against the Islamic State group, with 80% of people saying that they would support Congress approving military force. And 91% of Americans see the Islamic State group as a threat, a direct threat to U.S. interests. Phyllis, war weariness in the U.S. Over recent conflicts has led to polls saying that that the U.S. should get out, shouldn't be the world's policeman anymore. And then suddenly we have these latest polls. How do you explain that kind of turnaround in attitude?
This is very much a result of the media coverage and the officials in Washington describing the horrific events of the assassination, the murder of the two journalists. That was a horrific act, those two killings, the beheading of the two journalists. But we were never told a number of other things. One is that although the New York Times reported it, buried in an inside article, and no other U.S. media reported it at all, the so-called Free Syrian Army, the so-called moderates in Syria, beheaded six people just a day or two later. six people that we were never told about. They were allegedly ISIS fighters. There was another American ISIS fighter who the FSA killed, not by beheading, but it was the beheading of Americans that was built up into something that was translated into being a threat to the United States, not a threat to brave journalists who are trying to bring back a story to the United States, who tragically became the victims. But it was described not as that, but as somehow evidence that this is an attack on the United States. Similarly, when we heard the first justifications for the U.S. bombings in Iraq around Erbil, we were told that it was to protect Americans. What that says is, because there were something like 40 American diplomats and maybe a couple of, as many as a couple of hundred soldiers, that anywhere there are U.S. diplomats, which means pretty much anywhere in the world, where there is a threat from someone, not targeting those Americans, not aimed at those Americans, but where American diplomats happen to be or where American soldiers happen to be, that that somehow gives the United States military the right to go in bombing that country. It's an astonishing recognition that if any other country made that claim, the world would be in a very serious place.
Ibrahim Shaki, I want to pick up on something that that Ali Kaderi was saying just a moment or two ago about President Obama's leadership, this benign neglect, as he described it. How would Sunni Arab states react to John Kerry's call to join this coalition? Would they be willing to commit to the fight against what is an extremist but still a Sunni group? And to what extent are they wary of the quality of President Obama's leadership and the way in which he handles foreign policy?
Well, that's a very good question. First of all, let me say that it seems like we don't learn from our lessons. Yes, 76% support for the war against ISIL. And also the other thing, actually, the other part of the polls that we heard that there is 65% actually of American support for U.S. military strikes, even in Syria, that was much lower in the past. It's like we're going to repeat the lessons, and we're going to spread the war into other areas rather than containing it in Iraq. Sunnis have learned that, also have their learned their own lessons, where the war in Iraq against Saddam in the past ended up is supporting one part of this sectarian divide. And now the Sunnis are facing serious challenges of joining such a war that it's going, it seems like the U.S. wars in the region just removing the foes of Iran, whether it was in Afghanistan with Taliban, whether it was in Iraq with Saddam Hussein, and now with another Sunni group. So it's one after the other, and which adds, which makes it more complicated and more difficult for the Sunni, whether it's the Sunni governments or even the Sunni in Iraq itself. Keep in mind that we have now just formed a new government in Iraq, and where one major reason that contributed to the emergence of ISIL in Iraq was the frustration and the dissatisfaction of the sectarian government in Iraq, of the Maliki government. And now we come and form a new government that has now almost the old faces of the Sunni representatives in the government. We have Najafi and the others also that they were part of the Maliki government. So not sure this is this government, new government in Iraq, is appealing to the Sunni community inside Iraq itself. Okay. Which is going to make it even more complicated to bring them together.
You raised some issues there that I want to put to Ali in just a moment. But first, very briefly, if you can, is cost an issue here? We talk about learning the lessons of the past. Of course, the Iraq war, phenomenally expensive, cost the American taxpayer. Is this why John Kerry is perhaps courting the rich Gulf nations right now? And are they going to set conditions for taking part in this coalition?
Well, that's one major thing, cost, of course, and joining of the Gulf states in particular will be needed for the U.S. government to form this coalition. But even more difficult than that, actually, without regional participation, this campaign cannot even begin. And all the nine countries that you mentioned in the beginning, none of them is an Arab country in the regional country. And without an alliance with the region, you cannot even begin this, and these strikes. and will end up being like that, because this lacks the major components of any military intervention, which is legitimacy.
Ali Kaderi in Dubai. This coalition will set out, albeit reluctantly, to become engaged in what are essentially civil wars in both Iraq and in Syria. Is there a danger that by targeting, picking up from what Mohammed was saying just a few moments ago, is there a danger that by targeting a Sunni extremist group in Iraq, the coalition will be accused, become mired in, of siding with one side in a sectarian conflict?
There is that potential, but I think really the devil here is in the details. I do not believe we could characterize ISIS as a Sunni extremist group. I think ISIS, in fact, is the biggest enemy of Islam, is the biggest enemy of humanity. They are, frankly, savages. There is no other word for it. They do not represent any Sunnis in the world that I am, as far as I'm concerned. At the same time, we have militants from the Shia community, Shia Islamist militias backed by Iran's Revolutionary Guards, Badr Corps, Asab al-Haq, Kitab Hezbollah, among many others, along with Lebanese Hezbollah and the Assad regime. And they're also, these are not civil wars in Iraq and in Syria, they are regional proxy wars, increasingly with global components like Russia's assistance and backing for Iran, Syria, and Iraq, and the US and Western powers backing some of the more moderate elements like the Kurds. So that's the danger, is that this conflict continue to expand further and further and further, as I and others have been predicting for years now. In terms of the way ahead, what is important is that the roots of these crises are, again, the misrule out of Baghdad and in Damascus. And so the root solutions are a new way of doing business in those two capitals. I think the Assad government is at this point irreconcilable, just like Nouri al-Maliki's cabinet was. And we have taken a first major new step forward in the formation of the Abadi government. There are some excellent leaders at its helm at this point. For example, Hoshyar Zebari as deputy prime minister, Adel Abdel Mehdi as oil minister, Roch Chaouez as finance minister. These are great statesmen that are known, proven quantities. But we don't have, for example, interior and defense ministers in Baghdad, which is obviously quite difficult at this time when Iraq faces an existential threat to its security. And the reason why we don't have interior and defense ministers is Iran, for example, which is the patron of some of the most powerful forces in Baghdad. Iran has been pressing for Hadi al-Amri, commander of the Badr Corps, a wholly owned subsidiary of Iran's Revolutionary Guards. They've been pressing for him to be either defense minister or interior minister, and that would be unacceptable to Iraq's Sunnis.
Yeah, as we said, politics or even coalitions make for strange bedfellows then. It's odd that the US and its allies now appear to share an interest in defeating extremists with governments like Iran that they would otherwise oppose. Phyllis Bennis, does the Islamic State group, as John Kerry says, pose an opportunity for the world to unite? Is this core coalition group big enough? What about Russia and China? Where do they fit into this?
Well, I think there's another problem. If you define the coalition in military terms, it's going to fail and it will not expand and should not expand, frankly. The goal is not to have Russia and China in their bombing also. This is not going to help. There needs to be an end to this military focus with, oh yeah, we also have to have some diplomacy somewhere, some humanitarian somewhere, but this is all about the military. I would have hoped that we had learned the lesson, which clearly governments have not learned, at least my own government has not learned, the lesson that you cannot wipe out a government, an organization or an ideology by bombing it. It just doesn't work. They tried that with Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan. That was the goal of the first war in Afghanistan. We're going to wipe out Al-Qaeda. They did manage to wipe out a lot of the individuals who were at the leadership at that time. But look what happened. It spread throughout, what is it now, in more than a dozen countries. That's the threat that we see right now. This is not the threat of mission creep. This is already mission leap that we're seeing. It's already underway. We need a coalition. It needs to be broader. It needs to involve Russia and China and all of the regional actors in a diplomatic initiative, not based on the military part first.
John Kerry wants this plan, he says, in place before the UN General Assembly later this month. What do you think that General Assembly will look like? Will there be a united front, a clarity over how to deal with Islamic State, or do you envisage something entirely different?
No. I think it will be entirely different. I think if the coalition was based on the need for united diplomatic action involving the United Nations and with the United Nations at its core, I think then there would be the possibility of a very unified General Assembly, which is far more important than the Security Council in terms of representation of the peoples of the world, the governments of the world, not the very narrow and veto-paralyzed Security Council. The way it's being constructed now, where this is really about a coalition of the killing, there is not going to be support for that. It is understood that more bombing is going to make things worse. The fact that we're already seeing evidence, if anyone doubted it, that the weapons being used by ISIS are U.S.-provided weapons over these years of glutting that region with more arms. There needs to be discussion starting of an arms embargo. That needs to start in the UN General Assembly. It can't happen right away, but it needs to begin the notion of a real arms embargo on all sides. As long as it's focused on how are we going to bomb more, it's going to fail.
Ibrahim, will two questions. Will the favored U.S. policy of getting the Baghdad government to offer enough concessions to the Sunni minority lure them away from supporting Islamic State in Iraq? And as far as Syria is concerned, if they build this coalition of the willing, how can it avoid backing President Assad, who, remember, controls the main armed opposition to Islamic State in Syria, or is this coalition going to fight on two fronts?
Thank you. Well, the first question is also related to what my colleague from Dubai mentioned, and let me just slightly disagree with him on the issue of the ISIL. ISIL, first of all, is a Sunni. I mean, this is a fact. This is not an analysis. Whether it's representative of the Sunni Sunnis or not, no, it's not, definitely not representative. But let's keep in mind that what contributed to the emergence of the ISILs in Iraq is the sectarian conflict and the sectarian dimension of the Iraqi government, the Nour al-Maliki government, that marginalized the entire Sunni community in Iraq and contributed and pushed the Sunni community to ally as a result of a frustration with ISIL or with other extremist groups. And on the other hand, also contributed to the emergence of ISIL is this is the sudden collapse of the Iraqi army, the sectarian Iraqi army that Nour al-Maliki built, and that contributed to that.
Okay. So that's the one. The second part of that, be very brief if you can.
Okay, the second part of this, very briefly, if there is no political solution in Syria, this war is going to fail, and it will not provide any solutions whatsoever, because the sources or the root causes of these conflicts and extremism are political, need political solutions, need counter ideology, do not need additional bombing.
Ali, I think this is going to be a final question to you, very brief if you can, please. Picking up on what Phyllis was saying about an arms embargo, will the US and its Western allies allow countries like Saudi Arabia or the Gulf states to funnel weapons to groups fighting against Islamic State? Is there a danger, as they have done in Syria, that those weapons will end up in the hands of the very people that they're supposed to be being used against?
This is a very complicated issue and question. The reality is, while an arms embargo in the Middle East is a nice concept, sort of like communism, in reality, it's just not workable. For example, you know, the Russians are arming the Iranians and Syrians into the teeth. And so what you need is Western arming of our GCC allies and NATO powers like Turkey. That's just the reality on the ground. With regards to Iraq and Syria specifically, because of the intervention of the Russians, for example, and the Chinese in some cases, President Obama has publicly called for and covertly is probably already arming elements of the Free Syrian Army. Like we did during the surge, there is probably some covert assistance ongoing with the Sunni Arab tribes in Iraq. And obviously, Secretary Hagel has talked extensively about a coalition of a dozen countries arming Iraq's Kurds, along with Baghdad, ironically enough. If we're not careful, we could be setting the stages for a civil war.
Okay.
But otherwise, you need arms.
I'm afraid we must end it. Thank you to all of my guests today. Ibrahim Shakir here in Doha, Ali Kaderi in Dubai, and Phyllis Bennis in Washington, D.C. And thank you for watching. Please do give us your thoughts on our discussion. You can leave your comments at facebook.com/AJInsideStory. We're also on Twitter at AJInsideStory, our Twitter handle. In Doha, I'm Adrian Finnegan. Thanks for watching. I'll see you again. Bye for now.